You think back to when science fiction got its beginnings, most of the articles and ideas were printed in the pulp magazines, and they were always illustrated. So while the author's words would help understand a lot of the science part and stir our imaginations, they were also smart enough to use our eyes, which is where we take in most of our information. And artists were able to paint things that were only existent in people's hearts and ideas and minds and in science fiction. So there was an early marriage of the two, and that marriage continues today. I mean, here we are maybe, what, 60, 70 years later, and those who still want to reach people's hearts and imaginations aren't really doing it with photography like they are with art. And what I'm referring to is an experience in my life when I asked George Lucas, why do you insist upon illustration to represent your works and your films? And why does he keep coming back to me more specifically? And his answer was pretty much the same as what I'm talking about, that is that art is able to reach the heart in a much more fantastic and beautiful and open-minded way than photography is, because photography seems to say, this is reality. Art is able to reach the heart and open the mind rather than limit it. So George feels that way. Steven Spielberg says, you know, when I paint E.T., he is more real than real. We can really see his heart. And that's what art directs its expression to. And it's then a perfect marriage with science fiction to see things you have never seen, feel things that you have yet to feel and experience, you know, go where no man has gone before. Star Wars, special edition. Special for me, special for the audience, special for George Lucas. And everybody wants the job, and who's gonna get it? I had no idea. I got a call late one night, and I mean late, like 9 o'clock at night. The phone rings. Usually I don't answer that time of night, but I was glad I answered this time. It was Lucasfilm. So the film's gonna come out in like a month. We have to get the poster distributed, printed, and painted. So you think you can paint a picture in a week? For Star Wars special edition, you bet I can. So, right on the phone. So, what do you want? I says, well, we have a basic concept that we've been working on for a year, some sort of what we like, but it needs the magic touch. They actually faxed it to me. I could look at it while we're on the phone. And as is the way with a creative, I had to stir the stoop and make trouble. So I said, gee, one painting for three movies? After 20 years, don't you think it'd be nice to have three? I said, well, what do you have in mind? He said, let's take advantage of this opportunity. We have three movies. When does that ever happen? They come out all at once. Let's do three posters and make it a triptych. And I talked for about 10 minutes about what I envisioned right on the spot. And they had artists sitting there at Lucasfilm drawing what I was talking about. And then they faxed it to me and they said, like this. I said, yeah, that looks good. And they said, okay. And that's how the job was designed, where the idea came from, and how I got started. They said, okay, do the first one. We need it in a week, without a drawing, without a comp, without a color idea. I just began painting. And 1 week later, I had finished the first one and sent it to them. And then I had a week to do the next one, and a week to do the next one. And that was hard enough, but I had to have the three work together without ever seeing them together. I had to match and balance the colors without ever painting them together. So it was very difficult. It was a very difficult assignment. And that wasn't the hardest part. The hardest part was knowing that I had to outdo thousands of other artists who had been painting for 20 years trying to do the quintessential Star Wars. So I had my work cut out for me. And so it was an interesting assignment, but it still was the assignment of 20 years. And the assignment of a lifetime, truly. But you can see here a copy of what happened. We know that when the posters were printed, they were printed separately, and if you had your eye on them and understood, you could put all three together and create one big picture. And this really is an example of a limited edition I did of the three, where they were finally put together as one piece. And here you can see where the compositional idea came from. That they basically had this concept of making this asymmetric design, that is, you know, lopsided to one side. So I used that basic idea here, but repeated it in a mirror image on that side. So you can see it's exactly the same kind of composition going there. And then in the center, it's symmetrical, that is, everything's lined up on the middle. And that's where the basic concept came from. So you can see that there's also literal lines drawn that pass from the center right out through the action and the spaceships and the perspectives going this way and out that way. So that it becomes really one painting based on that one center point. And it's the only way I could get three to work together, only doing one at a time. And design it over the telephone. So it actually did work out good. It was probably until episode one, it was probably the most widely accepted, reproduced, and collected posters of all time. And still, you know, a very marked place in poster history, if not film history, for paintings, because it still stands as the only triptych ever done to really stand together as one piece of art. They didn't want somebody's name interfering with their advertising. That's the excuse they gave me for telling me don't sign it or taking my signature off pieces. Things have changed in the past, but there was a time when I couldn't sign it, so I devised this sneaky little way of identifying my work. I put a symbol on it, kind of a disguised S, so those who were following my work could find that when it was and was not mine. That looking here at Indy was the funniest example, because when they took this piece of art and made the album of music from the film, it was a gatefold, a double fold. He opened it up and there was all these Egyptian arches running across the page. Well, they had some other artist redraw and paint according to what I had here in the poster. And as they repeated the hieroglyphics, they also repeated this little square with the slash across it, this little Egyptian symbol, which really was my signature. That's a little S I used to use. It was so well disguised, they repeated it across the album. So I thought that was a great return for not letting me sign it. But now, as you can see, I get to sign it right up front, and if I don't include it, they say, we want one change. Put your signature on it. You know, the first time I met Stephen was on E.T. Project, before there was an E.T. We met and we were talking about doing a trade ad to promote the idea to try and get financing for the film, this little film he was making. You know, E.T. never really existed as a real person. I mean, it is science fiction after all. But so, you know, the puppet, kind of like the Muppets or something, you know, as long as they're moving and talking, you have a sense of reality. But when you take a still picture of it, it loses its life and its spirit. And so the best translation of him is in painting, because again, the painting can bring that life and spirit and breath back to the creature. So Stephen always seemed to like what I did to him. And he also recognized that I kind of changed him a little bit from what he really looked like. I changed his proportions to be a little bit more pleasing. Those big, beautiful eyes, a little bit prettier, a little bit of a grin. So he looked much more approachable instead of the ugly little snail or whatever he was. So he always liked that. In fact, the one that's sitting here is the one that Stephen called the quintessential E.T., because it's how Stephen sees him, and he obviously knows him better than any of us.